Have you ever woken up in the morning from a dream and the dream has been so vivid, so real? You ever had those things when you think that dream was so real that when you go out and meet other people or whatever, you feel like maybe your history has changed. Something happened in the dream and you can't remember whether it happened out in the world or was part of the dream. And sometimes it might take just a little tentative inquiry to make sure things are as they were, as you remembered them. These vivid dreams often have something really important to tell us. And I would say that what was happening to Samuel in today's first reading was something like a really profound dream. God speaking within the depths of him, showing him his vocation, or at least trying to call him to work out what his vocation was. Samuel was very lucky because he had Eli. When Samuel hears the voice of God within him, he goes to check because it's so real what he's experienced that he thinks that he's being called from outside. You know, like when we wake up from a dream and we feel like it's real. So Samuel goes to check with Eli and says, "Here I am, you called me." And Eli says, "It wasn't me, go back to sleep." Second time, he goes to Eli and says, "You called me, you know, what's going on?" And then Eli cottons on. Probably because he understands from his own experience what is going on. This real experience of God, the God who lives inside, is happening to Samuel. Now, what Eli could do, what he doesn't do, is tell Samuel what's going on. Right now, Eli has a lot of power. He can change the course of Samuel's life in one moment. He can say, "That is God, and God is telling you to do this." Now, Eli would be doing it with the best intentions in the world. He'd be desiring to give Samuel what he had, transfer his experience of God, and say, "Samuel, I can teach you the way to work out what God is trying to say." Good intentions, bad outcome if we do that. Because God is not speaking through Eli to Samuel, he's speaking to Samuel. And if Eli were to tell Samuel what was going on, it wouldn't be fair. Samuel would be separated from his own experience of God in his life. And so the wise Eli says, "Go back to sleep, and when you hear that voice call you again, simply say, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" Now that is how you teach someone to discern their vocation. You get out of the way and you let God speak to them personally. In other words, you let them work it out. As parents, as teachers at home at the moment with the schools closed, as members of the church, as clergy like myself, we would all do well to remember this. It's hard to let go and to let our loved ones make their own mistakes and go down their own pitfalls. But we do well to let our children do this, or anyone who is hearing the call of God. Because those mistakes, as we learn from the history of the whole Bible, are actually part of the story. They're part of the success, the death and the resurrection, the fall and the rise. And so, we move on to the gospel. And do you notice something here? Follows on from the story of Samuel. John, who has been in the desert, discerning Christ for many years, doesn't see Jesus and do a calculation. He knows through intuition from a voice inside. The voice that he's been listening to in the desert, away from all instruction, away from all people and all the rabbis who tell him it's this and that. And he has an intuition, a voice from within, and he goes, "Look, there is the Lamb of God." Now, He doesn't tell the disciples, and this means this. He's the Messiah. He's the one. You must go and follow him and do whatever he says. He just says, there is the Lamb of God. And the disciples leave him and go after Jesus. And then when they get to Jesus, Jesus like turns to them and says, what do you want? Now that's interesting, because the question he's asking is not the question they don't have the answer for. Because they say, Rabbi, where do you live? They've come to learn from him, and he's asked them, what do you want? And they don't know. And so he says, come and see. In other words, come and experience. Come and have an experience like John, so that you might work out for yourself who I am. So that who I am may be transferred into you and become your experience. That's what Jesus is trying to do for them, helping them to listen to their inner voice. John and Jesus have something in common. Before they ever spoke a word from their mouth, they stepped back, like Samuel, and listened. They meditated, they prayed before they spoke. And then they never gave instruction and said, this is how it must be. But rather they taught first by example, and then by garnering a following and teaching in a way that we could work out our path to Christ. And then Jesus himself has an intuition, and he looks hard, as John the Baptist looked hard at him, at Simon. Now, there's something about this looking hard. What does it mean? It means Jesus and John looking into the soul of the person. And then he says to Peter at the start of the ministry, you are Cephas, meaning rock. Peter doesn't know what that means. Jesus allows him to discover what it means. And Peter finds out when he says to Jesus, you are the Christ. So perhaps that is the one thing common to all of our journeys, our unique journeys, when we listen to the voice of God. Well, we come to a point in our life, in our own context, whatever we're doing, where we can say from within here, not because it's taught, but because it comes from within here, as we say to Jesus, you are the Christ for me. Amen.